We are continuing Wonder by R.J. Palacio. My name is Mrs. Brock. Today we're going to be starting with page 275 with the aftermath. If you are chilling at home, grab you a drink, a snack. Enjoy it while I read. Mom was waiting for me in front of the school along with all the other parents when the bus arrived. Mr. Tushman told me on the bus ride home that they had called my parents to tell them there had been a situation the night before, but that everyone was fine. He said the camp director and several of the counselors went looking for the hearing aid in the morning while we all went swimming in the lake, but they couldn't find it anywhere. Roar would reimburse us the cost of the hearing aids, he said. They felt bad about what happened. I wondered if Eddie had taken my hearing aids with him as a kind of a souvenir, something to remember the orc by. Mom gave me a tight little hug when I got off the bus, but she didn't slam me with questions like I thought she might. Her hug felt good, and I didn't shake it off like some of the other kids were doing with their parents' hugs. The bus driver started unloading our duffel bags, and I went to find mine while Mom talked to Mr. Tushman and Miss Rubin, who had walked over to her. As I rolled my bag toward her, a lot of kids who don't usually say anything to me were nodding hello or patting my back as I walked by them. "Ready?" Mom said when she saw me. She took my duffel bag, and I didn't even try to hold on to it. I was fine with her carrying it. If she wanted to carry me on her shoulders, I would have been fine with that too, to be truthful. As we started to walk away, Mr. Tushman gave me a quick, tight hug, but didn't say anything. Mom and I didn't talk much the whole walk home, and when we got to the front stoop, I automatically looked in the front bay window because I forgot for a second that Daisy wasn't going to be there like always, perched on the sofa with her front paws on the windowsill, waiting for us to come home. It made me kind of sad when we walked inside. As soon as we did, Mom dropped my duffel bag and wrapped her arms around me and kissed me on the head and on my face like she was breathing me in. "It's okay, Mom, I'm fine," I said, smiling. She nodded and took my face in her hands. Her eyes were shiny. "I know you are," she insisted. "I missed you so much, Augie." "I missed you too. Are you hungry?" she asked. "Starving. Can I have a grilled cheese?" "Of course," she said, and immediately started to make a sandwich while I took off my jacket and sat down on the kitchen counter. "Where's Via?" I asked. "She's coming home with Dad today. Boy, did she miss you, Augie," Mom said. "Yeah? She would have liked the nature reserve. You know what movie they played? The Sound of Music. You'll have to tell her that. So, do you want to hear about the bad part or the good part first?" I asked after a few minutes, leaning my head on my hand. "Whatever you want to talk about," she answered. "Well, except for last night, I had an awesome time," I said. "I mean, it was just awesome. That's why I'm so bummed. I feel like they ruined the whole trip for me." "No, sweetie, don't let them do that to you. You were there for more than 48 hours, and that awful part lasted 1 hour. Don't let them take that away from you, okay?" "I know," I nodded. "Did Mr. Tushman tell you about the hearing aids?" "Yes, he called us this morning."
"Was Dad mad? Because they're so expensive."
"Oh my gosh, of course not. Augie, he just wanted to know that you were all right. That's all that matters to us. And that you don't let those thugs ruin your trip." I kind of laughed at the way she said thugs.
"What?" she asked.
"Thugs," I teased her. "That's kind of an old-fashioned word." "Okay, jerks, morons, imbeciles," she said, flipping the sandwich in the pan. "Cretinos," as my mother would have said. "Whatever you want to call them if you saw them on the street." "I would," she shook her head. "They were pretty big, Mom," I smiled. "Seventh graders, I think."
"Seventh graders? Mr. Tushman didn't tell us that. Oh my goodness."
"Did he tell you how Jack stood up for me?" I said. "And Amos was like, bam, and he rammed right into the leader. They both crashed to the ground like in a real fight. He was pretty awesome. Amos's lip was bleeding and everything."
"He told us there was a fight, but," she said, looking at me with her eyebrows raised, I'm just grateful you and Amos and Jack are fine. When I think about what could have happened," she trailed off, flipping the grilled cheese again.
"My Montauk hoodie got totally shredded."
"Well, that can be replaced," she answered. She lifted the grilled cheese onto a plate and put the plate in front of me on the counter. "Milk or white grape juice?"
"Chocolate milk, please." I started devouring my sandwich.
"Oh, can you do it that special way you make it with the froth?"
"How did you and Jack end up at the edge of the woods in the first place?" she said, pouring the milk into a glass.
Jack had to go to the bathroom, I answered, my mouth full. As I was talking, she spooned in the chocolate powder and started rolling a small whisk between her palms really, really fast. But there was a huge line and he didn't want to wait. So we went toward the woods to pee. She looked up at me while she was whisking. I know she was thinking we shouldn't have done that. The chocolate milk in the glass now had a 2-inch froth on top. That looks good, Mom. Thanks. Then what happened? She said, putting the glass in front of me. I took a long drink of the chocolate milk. Is it okay if we don't talk about it anymore right now? Oh, okay. I promise I'll tell you about it later when Dad and Via came home. I'll tell you all every detail. I just don't want to have to tell the whole story over and over, you know? Absolutely. I finished my sandwich in 2 more bites and gulped the chocolate milk. Wow, you practically inhaled that sandwich. Do you want another one? She said. I shook my head and wiped my mouth with the back of my hand. Mom, am I always going to have to worry about jerks like that? I asked. Like, when I grow up, is it always going to be like this? She didn't answer right away, but took my plate and glass and put them in the sink and rinsed them with water. There are always going to be jerks in the world, Augie, she said, looking at me. But I really believe, and Daddy really believes, that there are more good people on this earth than bad people, and the good people watch out for each other and take care of each other, just like Jack was there for you and Amos and those other kids. Oh yeah, Miles and Henry, I answered. They were awesome too. It's weird because Miles and Henry haven't even really been very nice to me at all during the year. Sometimes people surprise us, she said, rubbing the top of my head. I guess. Want another glass of chocolate milk? No, I'm good, I said. Thanks, Mom. Actually, I'm kind of tired. I didn't sleep too good last night. You should take a nap. Thanks for leaving me Babu, by the way. You got my note? She smiled. I slept with him both nights. She was about to say something else when her cell phone rang, and she answered. She started beaming as she listens. Oh my goodness, really? What kind? She said excitedly. Yep, he's right here. He was about to take a nap. Want to say hi? Oh, okay, see you in 2 minutes. She clicked it off. That was Daddy, she said excitedly. He and Via are all down the block. He's not at work, I said. He left early because he couldn't wait to see you, she said. So don't take a nap quite yet. 5 seconds later, Dad and Via came through the door. I ran into Dad's arms and he picked me up and spun me around and kissed me. He didn't let me go for a full minute until I said, Dad, it's okay. And then it was Via's turn and she kissed me all over like she used to when I was little. It wasn't until she stopped that I noticed the big white cardboard box they had brought in with them. What is that? I asked. Open it, said Dad, smiling, and he and Mom looked at each other like they knew a secret. Come on, Augie, said Via. I opened the box. Inside was the cutest little puppy I've ever seen in my life. It was black and furry with pointy little snout and bright black eyes and small ears that flopped down. We called the puppy Bear because when Mom first saw him, she said he looked just like a little bear cub. I said, that's what we should call him, and everyone agreed that that was the perfect name. I took the next day off from school, not because my elbow was hurting me, which it was, but so I could play with Bear all day long. Mom let Via stay home from school too, so the two of us took turns cuddling with Bear and playing tug-of-war with him. We had kept all of Daisy's old toys, and we brought them out now to see which ones he'd like best. It was fun hanging out with Via all day, just the two of us. It was like old times, like before I started going to school. Back then, I couldn't wait for her to come home from school so she could play with me before starting her homework. Now that we're older, though, and I'm going to school and have friends of my own that I hang out with, we never do that anymore. So it was nice hanging out with her, laughing and playing. I think she liked it, too. When I got back to school the next day, the first thing I noticed was there was a big shift in the way things were. A monumental shift. A seismic shift. Maybe even a cosmic shift. Whatever you want to call it, it was a big shift. Everyone, not just in our grade, but every grade, had heard about what had happened to us in the 7th graders, so suddenly I wasn't known for what I'd always been known for, but for this other thing that had happened. And the story of what happened had gotten bigger and bigger each time it was told. 2 days later, the way the story went was, Amos had gotten to a major fist fight with the kid, and Miles and Henry and Jack had thrown some punches at the other guys too. And the escape across the field became this whole long adventure through a corn maze and into a deep, dark woods. Jack's version of the story was probably the best because he's so funny, but in whatever version of the story, and no matter who was telling it, 2 things always stayed the same. I got picked on because of my face, and Jack defended me, and those guys, Amos, Henry, and Miles, protected me. And now that they had protected me, I was different to them. It was like I was one of them. They all called me little dude now, even the jocks. These big dudes I barely even knew before would knuckle punch me in the hallways now. Another thing to come out of it was that Amos would become super popular, and Julian, because he missed the whole thing, was really out of the loop. Miles and Henry were hanging out with Amos all the time now, like they switched best friends. I'd like to be able to say that Julian started treating me better too, but that wouldn't be true. He still gave me dirty looks across the room. He still never talked to me or Jack, but he was the only one who was like that now. And me and Jack, we could care less. The day before the last day of school, Mr. Tushman called me into his office to tell me they had found out the names of the seventh graders from the nature retreat. He read off a bunch of names that didn't mean anything to me, and then he said the last name, Edward Johnson. I nodded. You recognize the name? He said. They called him Eddie. Right. Well, they found this in Edward's locker. He handed me what was left of my hearing aid headband. The right piece was completely gone, and the left one was mangled. The band that connected the two, the lobot part, was bent down the middle. His school wants to know if you want to press charges, said Mr. Tushman. I looked at my hearing aid. No, I don't think so. I'm being fitted for new ones anyway. Why don't you talk about it with your parents tonight? I'll call your mom tomorrow to talk about it with her, too. Would they go to jail, I asked. No, not jail, but they'd probably go to juvie court. And maybe they'll learn a lesson that way. Trust me, that Eddie kid is not learning any lessons, Isla joked. He sat down behind a desk. Augie, why don't you sit down a second? I sat down. All the things on his desk were the same as when I first walked into his office last summer. The same mirrored cube, the same little globe floating in the air. That felt like ages ago. Hard to believe this year's almost over, huh? He said, almost like he was reading my mind. Yeah. Has it been a good year for you, Augie? Has it been okay? Yeah, it's been good, I nodded. I know academically it has been a great year for you. You're one of our top students. Congrats on the high honor roll. Thanks. Yeah, that's cool. But I know it's had its shares of ups and downs, he said, raising his eyebrows. Certainly that night at the nature reserve was one of the low points. Yeah, I nodded. But it was also kind of good, too. In what way? Well, you know how people stood up for me and stuff? That was pretty wonderful, he said, smiling. Yeah, I know in school things got a little hairy with Julian at times. I have to admit he surprised me with that one. You know about that stuff? I asked him. Middle school directors have a way of knowing a lot of stuff. Do you have, like, secret security cameras in the hallways? I joked. And microphones everywhere, he laughed. No, seriously? He laughed again. No, not seriously. Oh, but teachers know more than kids think. Augie, I wish that you and Jack had come to me about the mean notes that were left in your lockers. How do you know about that? I said. I'm telling you, middle school directors know all. It wasn't that big of a deal, I answered. And we wrote notes, too. He smiled. I don't know if it's public yet, he said, though it will be soon anyway, but Julian Albans is not coming back to Beecher Prep next year. What? I said. I honestly couldn't hide how surprised I was. His parents don't think Beecher Prep is a good fit for him, Mr. Tushman continued, raising his shoulders. Wow, that's big news, I said. Yeah, I thought you should know. Then suddenly I noticed that the pumpkin portrait that used to be behind his desk was gone, and my drawing, my self-portrait as an animal that I drew for New Year Art Show, was now framed and hanging behind his desk. Hey, that's mine, I pointed. Mr. Tushman turned around like he didn't know what I was talking about. Oh, that's right, he said, tapping his forehead. I've been meaning to show you this for months now. My self-portrait as a duck, I nodded. I love this piece, Augie. When your art teacher showed it to me, I asked her if I could keep it for my wall. I hope that's okay for you. Oh, yeah, sure. What happened to the pumpkin portrait? Right behind you. Oh, yeah, nice. I've been meaning to ask you since I hung this up, he said, looking at it. Why did you choose to represent yourself as a duck? What do you mean, I answered. That was the assignment. Yes, but why a duck? He said. Is it safe to assume that it was because of the story of, the duckling that turns into a swan? No, I laughed, shaking my head. It's because I think I look like a duck. Oh, said Mr. Tushman, his eyes opening wide. He started laughing. Really, huh? Here I was looking for symbolism and metaphors, and sometimes a duck is just a duck. Yeah, I guess, I said, not quite getting what he thought it was so funny. He laughed to himself for a good 30 seconds. Anyway, Augie, thanks for chatting with me, he said, finally. I just want you to know it's truly a pleasure having you here at Beecher Prep, and I'm really looking forward to next year. He reached across the desk, and we shook hands. See you tomorrow at graduation. See you tomorrow, Mr. Tushman. This was written on Mr. Brown's chalkboard when we walked into English class for the very last time. Mr. Brown's June precept, just follow the day and reach for the sun. The polyphonic spree. Have a great summer vacation, Class 5B. It's been a great year and you've been a wonderful group of students. If you remember, please send me a postcard this summer with your personal precept. It can be something you made up for yourself or something you've read somewhere that means something to you. If so, don't forget the attribution, please. I really look forward to getting them. Tom Brown, with his address. The graduation ceremony was held in Beecher Prep Upper School Auditorium. It was only about a 15-minute walk from our house to the other campus buildings. But Dad drove at me because I was all dressed up and had on new shiny black shoes that weren't broken in yet, and I didn't want my feet to hurt. Students were supposed to arrive at the auditorium an hour before the ceremony started, but we got there even earlier, so we sat in the car and waited. Dad turned on the CD player, and our favorite song came on. We both smiled and started bobbling our heads to the music. Dad sang along with the song, "Andy Would Bicycle Across Town in the Rain to Bring You Candy." "Hey, is my tie on straight?" I said. He looked and straightened it a tiny bit as he kept on singing. "And John would buy the gown for you to wear to prom." "Does my hair look okay?" I said. He smiled and nodded. "Perfect. You look great, Augie." "Via put some gel in it this morning," I said, pulling down the sun visor and looking in the little mirror. "It doesn't look too puffy." "No, it was very, very cool, Augie. I don't think you've ever had it this short before, have you?" "No, I got a cut yesterday. I think it makes me look more grown up, don't you?" "Definitely." He was smiling, looking at me and nodding. "But I'm the luckiest guy on the Lower East Side, because I got wheels and you want to go for a ride." "Look at you, Augie," he said, smiling from ear to ear. "Look at you, looking so grown up and spiffy. I can't believe you're graduating from fifth grade." "I know, it's pretty awesome, right?" I nodded. "It feels just like yesterday that you started. Remember, I still had that Star Wars braid hanging from the back of my head." "Oh my gosh, that's right," he said, rubbing his hand over his forehead. "You hated that braid, didn't you, Dad?" "Hate is too strong of a word, but I definitely didn't love it." "You hated it. Come on, admit it," I teased. "No, I didn't hate it, but I'll admit to hating that astronaut helmet you used to wear. Do you remember?" "The one Miranda gave me? Of course I remember. I used to wear that thing all the time." "Good God, I hated that thing," he laughed, almost more to himself. "I was so bummed when it got lost," I said. "Oh, it didn't get lost," he answered casually. "I threw it out." "Wait, what?" I said, honestly didn't think I heard him right. "The day is beautiful and so are you," he was singing. "Dad," I said, turning the volume down. "What?" he said. "You threw it out?" He finally looked at my face and saw how mad I was. I couldn't believe he was being so matter-of-fact about the whole thing. I mean, to me, it was a major revelation. He was acting like it was no big deal. "Augie, I couldn't stand seeing that thing cover your face anymore. Dad, I love that helmet. It meant a lot to me. I was bummed beyond belief when it got lost. Don't you remember?" "Of course I remember, Augie." "Oh, Augie, don't be mad. I'm sorry. I just couldn't stand seeing you wear that thing on your head anymore, you know? I didn't think it was good for you." He was trying to look me in the eye, but I wouldn't look at him. "Come on, Augie, please, let me understand. You weren't wearing that helmet all the time, and the real truth is I miss seeing your face, Augie. I know you don't always love it, but you have to understand, I love it. I love this face of yours, Augie, completely and passionately, and it kind of broke my heart that you were covering up all the time." He was squinting at me like he really wanted me to understand. "Does Mom know?" "No way, are you kidding? She would have killed me. She tore the place apart looking for that helmet, Dad. I mean, we spent like a week looking for it in every closet everywhere. I know, that's why she'd kill me." "Wait a minute, Augie. You have to promise me you'll never tell Mommy anything about this." I smiled and rubbed my palms together like I was getting very greedy. "Let's see. I'll be wanting a new Xbox and definitely wanting my own car in 6 years. A red Porsche would be nice." He started laughing. "Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy," he said, shaking his head. "You really have grown up." The part of the song we loved to sing the most started to play, and we both started singing. We always sang this last part at the top of our lungs, which always made us crack up. Which, while we were laughing, we noticed Jack had arrived and was walking over to our car. I started to get out. "Hold on. I just want to make sure you've forgiven me, okay?" "Yes, I forgive you." He looked at me gratefully. "Thank you. But don't ever throw anything else of mine out again and without telling me." "I promise." I opened the door and got out as Jack reached the car. "Hey, Jack." "Hey, Augie." "Hey, Mr. Pullman." "How you doing, Jack?" said Dad. "See you later." "Good luck, guys," Dad called out. "See you on the other side of fifth grade." We waved as we turned the ignition and started to pull out. And then I ran over and he stopped the car. I put my head in the window so Jack wouldn't hear what I was saying. "Can you guys not kiss me after graduation? It's kind of embarrassing." "I'll try my best. Tell Mom too, okay?" "I don't think she'll be able to resist, Augie, but I'll pass it along." "Bye, dear old Dad," he smiled. "Bye, my son, my son." And that's the end of page 293.